still working on getting more Warhammer books together, so today we're going to do another fairly different video. This is a comment I left on a Reddit writing prompt, and it's a story that, I mean, it's a short story, but I'm fairly proud of it, or at least I was when I wrote it, but I haven't read it since. So you and I will get to go through this again and see if it stands up. So the prompt was, "You are the first human on Mars. To your surprise, you find a platypus meandering around your base. There isn't much time. I know no one will believe my story. I hardly believe it myself, but it must be told. My path is not one we should ever take. The end is coming. I can feel it in the back of my mind, clawing, knocking, trying to get in. I can't keep it out forever. I wanted to be first. I knew being first would mean being remembered forever. A real Columbus type, but without the genocide. I wanted to be remembered as a hero to humanity. Someone they would write books about in 100 years. I guess in a way I am. I'm proof that we don't have a chance on the Red Planet. The write-up was easy. They strapped me into the single ship, basically a life pod strapped to thrusters 30 times its size, and told me that I was a hero. I'd been trained. I knew the plan. I knew every possible thing that could go wrong, and knew how to deal with them when they did. Things did go wrong, of course. It wouldn't be an adventure if I had made it there without any issues at all. It started when I defrosted, but the glass lid on my cryopod failed to open. It took hours of working at the seal to eventually get the emergency release to trigger. Looking at the instrument next to the hard metal shell that served as my bed for those 140 days, I saw I still had a few weeks before I would reach the surface of Mars. They gave me plenty of time to figure out why the lid release had failed before I had to ready my gear for touchdown. It turned out to be nothing. Some of the lubricant on the bearings had been exposed to too much heat during installation and had hardened over my trip. Thankfully, the emergency release basically blew the lid across the little space I would call home for the next 23 days, so there was never any risk of me being stuck inside that glass coffin like some sort of twisted sci-fi Snow White. The next 3 weeks and 2 days passed virtually uneventfully. I recorded text logs every day, as I am doing now. They contain the tasks I completed each day, mostly scanning the landing site to ensure nothing had fouled the ground, checking the radiation seals on the living portion of the single ship, and monitoring the massive nuclear reactor I was towing. Each one of these logs is stored on every computer and console that came with me in case someone decides to try to find out what happened to me. I pray no one ever does. The reactor was the only part that worried me. I was told that because of its proximity to my life vessel, radio communication would be virtually impossible until I landed, and was unable to position the reactor far enough away that it wouldn't fry. The antennas. Tight beam was out of the question. The craft hadn't even been equipped with one. A cost-saving measure, or wait, I can't remember anymore. I'm sorry if you can hear the train in the background. Wait for that to pass. If you're reading this, you know that I never even had the chance to set up the reactor, let alone send any transmission home. Hopefully you will understand why soon enough. Landing was equally uneventful. The autopilot did it all for me. All I had to do was tell it to lower the man ramp. Walking out onto the dusty surface of this foreign rock, I felt awe and relief wash over me. The horizon, obstructed by dust kicked up by the landing system, glowed an autumnal russet. There was utter quiet, save the slight rushing of the suit's oxygen recycler. As the dust cleared, I was struck by just how familiar Mars seemed. I had expected to feel out of place, like the alien that I was. Instead, I felt a sense of recognition. It didn't seem all that different from Earth, and that familiarity was disquieting in its comfort. It should have felt strange. It should have felt like a rock 34 million miles from home. Instead, it felt like I imagined Arizona looking. Granted, I've never been to Arizona, but the feeling of home was unshakable. Don't jump to conclusions now. Humans aren't from Mars. This madness is not as bad as that. It should have been alien. It wasn't. I chose to ignore my discomfort and proceed with the plan. The base was to be erected as a daisy chain of systems, a reactor on one end, followed by servers, water and air purification, living quarters, and comms. Whoever finds me will find none of that. By the second hour, I had set up the living quarters. The purification systems were next, and I had just begun to unpack the metal lattice that would serve as the building structure when I saw it. This little brown shape moving around in the dust, making its way towards me. I froze. There wasn't supposed to be life here, least of all anything macroscopic. What was this thing approaching me? It moved slowly enough, such that I was not afraid it would harm me. I was instead thrilled that I might be the one to discover life on Mars. As it got closer, my heart began to race, and it felt as if the suit's heating had completely failed. Cold sweat beaded my brow as I began to understand what it was I was looking at. A platypus. I believe it is in that moment I was broken. How does a sane mind reconcile seeing something where it is impossible to be seen? How does such an odd, innocuous little creature like a platypus end up on Mars, near the one spot where a human has landed? How can it be that luck should have the absurd appear before me? I know now it was a trick played by some cruel, abyssal thing that did not want me there. I do not know who or what it was. I do not know why it was. I only know that it wanted me gone, and so it will have its wish. I took down the living quarters. I destroyed the water and air purification systems. I packed every bit of electronics into the single ship to keep it safe from the thing that haunted me, but I do not know what good it will do. Maybe the next fool to come here will read what I have seen and flee before they too fall victim to the gods of this planet. The platypus remains. He does not leave my side. He follows me everywhere as if he, like me, is waiting for my suit to fail and my eventual slow death from exposure. The dark eyes watch me, studying me. I cannot meet their gaze, but neither can I look away. I walk aimlessly. The oxygen recycler in my suit is at 3%, yet I know I will not die from suffocation. There is a hill. That feeling of the coming end is emanating from it. I will walk towards it until I find the demon that torments me. The damned platypus will walk with me. I know he will. He is my only companion, my executioner. I will walk. Do not follow my footsteps. And there you go. Other than some kind of weird wording here and there, I'm actually still fairly happy with that. But that was kind of short, so why don't we scroll back up in my comment history here, and there's another short story that I wrote, again, for a writing prompt, and this one actually got a lot of engagement, a lot of upvotes and comments and stuff like that. The prompt was, this is in quotations, "So, they are a war species then? Huh." The alien researcher scratched his head. "Why are you so interested in them? The humans, I mean." The other alien gets closer to him and says, "They fight for peace. No other species fights for peace." "You're right," Skith said. "No other species fights for peace. How can you possibly know what their motivation is?" "Well, they talk about it all the time," Fluck replied. "No one else talks about peace when they fight wars. Why would you? It's totally contradictory." "So what you're saying is these humans are complete lunatics who have no concept of the costs of warfare." "That's not it at all. They really think that by waging war, they will bring peace to their world," Fluck sighed. Here, he said, bringing up an old broadcast a human leader had written during one of their worldwide wars. The broadcast spoke of defeating another group, one this human was not part of, and how doing so would bring peace to their world. Jesus Christ, these humans, this is, you know, a replacement for another phrase, these humans are quite possibly the most idiotic beings that we have yet cataloged, Skith said. You haven't found some cosmic anomaly, you've discovered the village idiot of our arm of the galaxy. You know what's going to happen if we try to make contact with them, right? Yeah, replied Fluck. But maybe they won't. Maybe they'll just want to talk to us. They developed nuclear bombs before they developed solar power. This is not a species you want to be talking to. Skiths grabbed the tight beam handset and said something into the receiver. All right, time to go home. They'll be putting a quarantine on this planet. Maybe next time, Fluck. Well, and there you go. So I think this is actually a lot of fun also. So I may go through some of the good writing prompt responses and try giving some of those a read. But anyways, I hope you guys enjoyed this this shorter video. And I hope you think my writing's okay.